Right. And now for a little clip.
Dad! Dad! Hey, Dad! When's the show going to start? Hey, Dad?
Now look, son. This only happens once every couple of hundred years. If you don't pipe down, I will not bring you again. Shut up.
On? Oh, that's better. Morning, everybody. Well, I'm here for the game. And so, boys and girls, what was that? If we're talking about participation today, so what did the frogs say we should do? Anyone know? Can anyone guess what the frogs told us to do? Anybody? We all stand together. Right. So we're going to do a little game, and I'm going to need some people to help with participation. And we're going to play a game called... Can you put that behind the chair? We're going to play a game called In It to Win It. So you've got to be in it. So I want a couple of volunteers. Is someone going to come and help me? Jacob, I'm going to come. Oh, all right, come on in. Right, come and sit down there. Sit on the edge of the stage. Come on, I want somebody else, just a little bit old. I've got a volunteer, Millie, come. Move along a little bit, let Millie sit in here. Or come over. That's it. Now, I've got a team behind me. I'm one of these TV presenters, game compares, and you've got to have a little bit of imagination because I'm standing here with my best evening suit on, my white tie, white shirt and my bow tie, looking the part, and I have to have some helpers. So I have a very gorgeous helper. It's supposed to be Margaret, but she's unwell today, so she couldn't be it. So Val's come to help, to come and help me. Come over here, Val. And we have an even more gorgeous helper in Don. Don, can you put it behind the chair, please? Right. I got two helpers, but really I need three. So I really need an adult. And as if I put a hand up for volunteers, I'm not going to get anybody. So the nearest one to me is going to come and help me. Aren't you, Sue? would you just like to sit on the chair, please? Right. Now, it's a simple game. It's catch. And you're going to get three chances to catch the ball. And then we're going to see what the scores are afterwards. So, Val, can you sort out. So we got Millie first. One. Callum. Not Callum. And again. Two. Three. And three. And well done. Give them a big clap. Well done. That's the end of round one. So over to Dawn. Dawn, can you tell me what the scores on the doors are? Owen, sorry, it's my fault. And Sue got
none.
You got none, Sue. What? I want you to try harder next time. We're into round two, so that Sue can try a little bit harder. Can we all stand up, please? This time, we're going to make it a bit harder. So here we go again. One, two. That's it. Big clap for the end of round two. And the scores on the doors, please, Dawn. Wow. None. Come on, Sue. You're not trying very hard, are you? You did ask. But were you participating?
I was trying.
You're not trying hard enough. So, everyone stand up, we'll try it a third time and see where we go from here. One. Hey! Yeah! Great! Right, thank you everybody. You can take your seats now. Big clap for everybody. Now, the idea of the game was that we can all stand together, but if, as we all do as the church, we all come together, we all stand together, but you've got to be in it to win it. Now, we know that there is no race for life, for the life with Jesus, but he does ask us to be ready and willing to participate to the best of our ability whenever we can. And at the end of the game, as you saw, Sue did take part. So well done, Sue. Thanks ever so much. But, you know, it's easy to stand around and do nothing, but if you want to win it, you've got to be in it. Thank you. And now we go over to Sheila.
Right, now, I know that Trevor called for some helpers. But okay, you little guys, because you see, I'm only little. Don't anybody tall, just the little guys. Would you like to come and sit down here? I have got something special that I have written just for you. So can anybody under the age of 98 will do? Really don't mind. Nearly there myself. Come sit down here. Come on, the rest of you young people. I'm going to need you here. Come on, Mills. Isaac, where's Isaac? I thought I might have my big friends. Aha. Come on, that's it. Come on, guys. Okay. Now, it's quite important. Now, grown-ups, what I'm going to read is something that I think God gave me especially. Because when Val asked me if I would write something, I was about to say, I haven't got enough time, I can't. And then you have to learn to listen to God. Because sometimes he'll drop things into your heart and only you will know what it is. And nobody else will find out unless you listen to what he says and then work on it. I was about to say, no, I can't do it. And then four words dropped into my head. And I said to Val, just a minute. I wrote them down. I said, I'll give it a go. And I got home from church. That's two Sunday mornings ago. And I began to write. And I just think that God gave me this especially. And there's a special story within this that I think you will latch on to, but I want you to understand that at the end of the meeting, when, not at the end of the very end, after we've had communion, there's a table set up with craft work, and you'll be able to respond to what you hear now when you've thought about how it affects you. Okay, on with the story. Now, it's all about encouragement. Everyone can do their bit. It's about participation, and it's called the relay race. Now, Jim wasn't very good at sport. The truth is, he was rather short. His little legs could not go fast, which meant he always came in last. So, no one chose him for their team. Some of the kids were really mean. They used to point at him and shout, "Clear off, you skinny little lout. We just don't want you taking part. We'll lose the race before we start." Poor little Jim was very sad, for no one knew what skills he had. They never took time to find out what little Jim was all about. Sad they would be so unkind. Jim hoped that one day they would find there were some things that he could do. He wondered, should he tell a few? But he pondered, changed his mind and thought, I'll still be left behind. But then, amazingly, it seems, a brand new member joined the team. Jim knew he was not like the rest. He didn't treat Jim like a pest. He gave him time. Unlike the others, it seemed these two were more like brothers. He took his time in finding out exactly what Jim was about. He soon discovered his young friend could jump and gambol, climb and bend. A relay race was not his thing. His talents had gymnastics ring. He talked to Jim about this skill and said there was a gap to fill. The gymnast's team was one man short, and Jim could fill the space, he thought. For Jim, this was a new approach. His friend took him to meet the coach. He was impressed with Jimmy's skill. Please, will you join us? Yes, I will. Now, Jimmy proudly plays his part with a much encouraged little heart. I want you to think about how somebody being kind made all the difference, and you'll be able to think about people who've been kind to you, and you'll be able to make a card on the craft table after we've had communion. So will you join me there a bit later? Yes, come and join me there. Thanks for listening so well. Go back to your places. Great.
That That part was especially for the children, and this bit is particularly important for women, but I'm sure the men could listen in too. Our theme this week is participation, and we tend to think of this in terms of how and where we can participate. But what if we thought of how God already actively participates in our lives? And this is an article from a lady called Heather F., and she reflects on this. Have you ever noticed how in the scriptures, men are always going up into the mountains to commune with the Lord? Yet in the scriptures, we hardly ever hear of women going to the mountains. But we know why, right? Because the women were too busy keeping life going. They couldn't abandon babies, mills, homes, fires, gardens, and a thousand other responsibilities to make the climb into the mountains. I was speaking to a friend the other day, saying that as a modern woman, I feel like I'm never free enough from my responsibilities, never in a quite enough space to be with God. Her response floored me. Well, that is why God comes to women. Men have to climb the mountains to meet God, but God comes to women wherever they are. I've been pondering on her words for weeks and have searched the scriptures to see if what she said is really true. God does indeed come to women where they are, when they're busy doing their ordinary, everyday work. He met them at the wells where they drew water for their families, in their homes, in their kitchens, in their gardens. He came to them as they sat beside sick beds, as they give birth, as they cared for the elderly, and as they performed the necessary mourning and burial rites. Even at the empty tomb, Mary was the first to witness Christ's resurrection. And she was there because she was doing the womanly chore of properly preparing Christ's body for burial. In these seemingly mundane and ordinary tasks, these women of the scriptures found themselves face to face with divinity. So if, like me, you ever start to bemoan the fact that you don't have as much time to spend in the mountains with God as you would like, remember, God comes to women. He knows where we are and the burdens we carry. He sees us, and if we open our eyes and our hearts, we will see him, even in the most ordinary of places and in the most ordinary of situations. He lives. He participates in our lives. And he is using a time such as this to speak to women around the world.
Just as the worship team come back, can I just say a real sorry to people at home, because our live link actually wasn't working for some of the service. And just as we're preparing our hearts for communion, can we just lift Colin Brown, who needs our prayers today, and also Dave Gredley at home poorly. I'm just going to pray very quickly. Lord, would you just be with those who are not able to be with us? Lord, as we've just heard, Lord, you know their special needs, and we pray, Lord God, that you would be with them in a mighty way today. Over to you, Faith.
I think last week, as I was thinking about the service today, I had, I was in my kitchen. God met me where I was. I was in my kitchen, mooching around, and I just had a real sense. There's a song that we did before the service called I Speak Jesus. And myself and Jess are going to do that again in a moment for you as we prepare for communion. It says in Philippians 2, therefore God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at that name of Jesus, every knee should bow in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. I think just in those few short verses, it just speaks of how powerful the name of Jesus really is. And so when we talk about participation, I said it when we started, it's not always about participating and being active and coming along to things and using our gifts. Sometimes the most important bit is participating in what God is doing. being aware of what God is doing. Participation is not passive. It's proactive. You have to actively step in and do. And that applies to actively stepping in and doing and listening to what God is doing. And the name of Jesus is really powerful. And I would love for us, as we listen to this, if you know it, please do sing along. But if you don't know it, listen to the words. The words will be up on the screen. But have a think about the circumstances in your life, where you are at. And this applies to you young ones as well. What stuff have you got going on in your life where you could really do with speaking the name of Jesus over those things? What circumstances do we find ourselves in? Our families, our friends, where could we speak the name of Jesus? And if you've got a piece of paper or your Bibles, just jot that down and think about that and be proactive in speaking the name of Jesus. Participate in what God is doing. Thanks, Jess.
I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within your presence. I speak Jesus. I just want to speak the name of Jesus. Every dark addiction starts to break, declaring there is hope and there is freedom. I speak Jesus. 'Cause your name is power, your name is healing, your name is life. Break every stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over fear and all anxiety. To every soul held captive by depression, I speak Jesus. Shadows burn like a fire. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Your name is power, your name is healing. Stronghold, shine through the shadows, burn like a fire. I just want to speak the name of Jesus over every heart and every mind. 'Cause I know there is peace within his presence. I speak Jesus.
Amen.
Well, good morning. It is really good to be with you this morning. Those of you who don't know who I am, my name is Claire Blatchford. I'm one of the regional ministers for the Eastern Association. Last time I was here was back in January for Paul's induction, which seems a long time ago. Here we are heading into September. Where have those months gone? But so thank you so much for your welcome. We're going to share communion this morning, and we're going to do it a little bit differently. We've been thinking about participation. So I have got, I wouldn't say volunteers, but Val has conveniently found some people that will read some questions. And this involves everybody. Sometimes I think when we share communion, we can be guilty of just going through the motions and not necessarily thinking about what we're actually going to do. So I have seven people who are going to ask seven different questions. And what they're first going to say, they are going to say, I have a question. And then everybody here needs to respond, what is your question? And then they will read their question. So we've got a microphone. Val, are you going to be our runner? So who has question number one? Okay.
I have a question.
What is your question?
Why do we eat this meal together?
That is a great first question. Well, on the night of Jesus' arrest and betrayal, he sat round a table with his friends. This is a sign that we too are Jesus' friends. Question number two.
I have a question.
What is your question?
Why do we break some bread and share it?
Well, at that meal, Jesus took a loaf of bread, he broke it, and he shared it among those who had joined him for that special Passover meal. He said that the bread symbolized his body, which would be given for everyone when he died on the cross. Question number three.
I have a question.
What is your question?
Why do we have a cup with some juice in it?
Well, Jesus also took a cup of wine and shared it among his friends. He said it symbolized a new covenant in which his blood would be shed for the forgiveness of all our sins. All those things that we do, we think, or that we say that we shouldn't do, think, or say. Question number four.
You put your hands up, so...
I have a question.
What is your question?
Do we all have to eat?
No, we don't. Only those who love the Lord Jesus and want to love him more. But everyone is invited to participate, to eat, because it is Jesus himself who invites you here and not me. Question number five.
I have a question.
What is your question?
Why do we pray?
Well, Jesus taught his disciples to pray. And before he shared the bread and the wine at that meal, he gave thanks to his heavenly Father. And we're going to do that now. So let's pray. Gracious God, for loving us enough to share our humanity, born among us, walking this earth, experiencing our frailty and our fears, our joys and our sorrows. In awe and wonder, we thank you. For loving us enough to share our death, dying on a cross, bearing our sins, enduring our suffering and sorrow, darkness and despair. In awe and wonder, we thank you. For loving us enough to share your life. Life eternal, abundant, brimming over in all its fullness, beyond our finest words or wildest imagining. In awe and wonder, we thank you. Lord God, for inviting us to share in bread and wine, gratefully remembering, eagerly anticipating, conscious of all you have done and all you have yet to do. In awe and wonder, we thank you. Amen. Question number 6.
I have a question.
What is your question?
Why do we pass it around?
Well, it's a sign, really, that we are one family and that everyone is included in that family. In a few moments, that bread and wine is going to be passed around. You're invited to eat the bread as soon as you receive it, and then hold on to the cup until everyone has been served. And then we shall drink together as a sign that we are that one family. Jesus said, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is me. This is my body given for each one of you. Each time you eat, remember me." Jesus took a cup of wine filled to the brim and asked God's blessing upon it. And he passed it to his disciples, his followers, his friends, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink it. This is me. This is my promise in my life's blood, poured out for you and for the whole world. Each time you drink it, remember me." And so we, as Jesus' followers, as his friends, we eat bread and we drink wine. And we remember the sacrifice of Jesus, the one who calls us his friends. So those who are going to serve the bread and the wine, we should do that now. So we eat the bread when we receive it, and we shall drink together.
Love wider than oceans, grace deeper than seas. Even before my time began, the Father adopted me. Held near to your heartbeat, you hear when I call. Even when I can't see your hand, I know I can trust your heart. I know I can trust you, God. You followed me before my first breath. You'll father me into life beyond death. I know that every moment your grace has been over my life, and I thank you for fathering me. Twistings and turns, even when I can't hear your voice, I know I can trust your word. I know I can trust you, Lord. You fathered me before my first breath. Father me into life beyond death. bothered me before my first breath. You fathered me into life beyond death. I know that every moment your grace has been over my life, and I thank you for fathering me. You fathered me before my first breath. You fathered me into life beyond death. I know that every moment your grace has been over my life, and I thank you for fathering me. Yes, I thank.
We seem to have run out of wine, so those of us that have wine, we shall drink together. We are the body of Christ. Each one of you is a part of it. So we remember all that Christ has done for us, and we are thankful. Amen. So we have one last question. Sorry, Val. Number seven. Who's got number seven?
I have a question.
What is your question?
Will we always eat this meal together?
No, we won't. But in the meantime, we will continue to eat and celebrate all Jesus has done until he returns, as he has promised. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, as we have remembered your death and your love for us by eating this bread and drinking from this cup, help us to wait for you. Help us to watch for you, so that when you do come again, you will find us ready. For you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forevermore. Amen.
Reading is from Nehemiah 2, from verses 11 to the end. Nehemiah inspects Jerusalem's walls. I went to Jerusalem after staying there 3 days. I set out during the night with a few others. I had not told anyone what God had put in my heart to do for Jerusalem. There were no mounts with me except the one I was riding on. By night, I went out through the valley gate towards Jekyll, well, and Dung Gate, examining the walls of Jerusalem, which had been broken down, and its gates, which had been destroyed by fire. Then I moved on towards the fountain gate and the king's pool, but there was not enough room for my mount to get through. So I went up the valley by night, examining the wall. Finally, I turned back and re-entered through the valley gate. The officials did not know where I had gone or what I was doing, because as yet I had said nothing to the Jews, or the priests, nobles, officials, or any others who would be doing the work. Then I said to them, "You see the trouble we're in? Jerusalem lies in ruins, and its gates have been burned with fire. Come, let us rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. We will no longer be in disgrace." I also told them about the gracious hand of my God on me and what the king had said to me. They replied, "Let us start rebuilding." So they began this good work. But when Sanballat the Horonite, Tobiah the Ammonite official, and Geshem the Arab heard about it, they mocked and ridiculed me. "What is this you're doing?" they asked. "Are you rebelling against the king?" I answered them, saying, "The God of heaven will give us success. We, his servants, will start rebuilding, but as for you, you have no share in Jerusalem or any other claim or historic right to it." This is the word of God. Thank you.
Thanks, Brenda. Well, what an amazing time we've had together already this morning. It feels like that I have nothing really to add to what's already been said, but I guess I have to earn my keep, so I better bring something. I wonder how many of you have been watching the European Games this week or the Commonwealth Games in the last few weeks. I've been quite grateful that my diary in August has been a little bit quieter, because I've been able to catch up on some of the sport. You know, the BBC reported that the Commonwealth Games broke records with over 57 million streams during the Games. That is a lot of people watching the athletics and all the other sports. You know, and as athletes compete, they all seek a medal and the recognition that comes with it. Those who win a gold are held up as heroes. While most of us will have a desire to be recognised, our chances, I guess, of competing at the Commonwealth Games or the Olympic Games or any championship, for that matter, are pretty slim. Correct? Have I judged the congregation here at Rayleigh right? Okay. But people like to hear their name mentioned in a positive way. The Bible passage I had chosen for today actually follows the reading that Brenda just gave. And if you look at Nehemiah chapter 3, you will see why I didn't ask Brenda to read it out. Basically, the passage is a list of people who achieved some pretty major accomplishments, but they also have some very tricky names. At first glance, Nehemiah chapter 3 looks pretty dry. One Bible commentator refers to it as a colourless memorandum of assignments. It simply is a long list of names that are difficult to pronounce, information that seems redundant, and timelines that seem meaningless. It's hard to muddle through. And while we have skipped reading those 32 verses in Nehemiah 3 out loud, as we think today and reflect on the RBC value of participation, I believe that Nehemiah chapter 3 does contain great insights and principles that can have direct application to our lives today in 2022. So let me briefly set the historical context of Nehemiah. In 586 BC, Nebuchadnezzar and the Babylonian army captured the Jews, Jerusalem was destroyed, the walls were knocked down, and the temple was burned. The people were deported and were forced into slavery, and Jerusalem was left in ruins. But God did not desert his people. He moved King Cyrus to make a decree to let some of the Jewish people return. And in three stages, over 100 years, they were allowed to migrate back to Jerusalem, only to discover the city was still demolished and desolate. Let me make two preliminary observations. Firstly, chapter 3 reveals Nehemiah's extraordinary gift of administration and organization. He was able to mobilize and empower 44 separate groups of people for the task of rebuilding the walls of Jerusalem. Secondly, this passage shows how people participating and working together can accomplish more than if just one person tried to do all the work. If you scan through Nehemiah 3, you will find the following phrases: next to him, next to them, after him, after them. And these expressions are recorded 28 times in this chapter. The biblical principle is every person is to be involved in ministry because everybody has a job to do. And so in the words of your fourth value, we value participation because nobody's perfect, but everybody's welcome. And together we build God-centered communities. But I would hazard a guess that it's sometimes we find it hard to participate and find our place, don't we? Some of you are doing exactly what you need to be doing in life and in God's kingdom work, and that's fantastic. Others of you, I guess, are finding it hard to find your place, your niche. It's been said, I like work, it fascinates me. I can sit and look at it for hours. But when it comes to kingdom work, there is no place for sitting on the sofa because we are all called to participate. And as we see in Nehemiah 3, the wall workers accomplished an incredible task and in the process smashed a world record for teamwork. So what was the purpose of this work? Well, Nehemiah was able to build his community, his team, if you like, around a central rallying point. He pointed them to the purpose of the work being for the glory of God. They weren't just working on walls, they were worshipping God. The workers were disheartened about the conditions of the city and disgraced in the presence of their enemies. But they longed for God's city to regain its splendor and for God to be given the glory. The purpose of all ministry and really of life itself is for the glory of God. 1 Corinthians 10:31 puts it like this: so whenever you eat or drink or whatever you do it all for the glory of God. If we look at verse 1 of Nehemiah 3, it says, Eliashib, the high priest, and his fellow priests went to work and rebuilt the sheep gate. They dedicated it and set its doors in place. It's no accident that the list starts at the sheep gate. It's another way of saying, put God first. By beginning here, Nehemiah is establishing that their relationship with God was central. The gate was closest to the temple, and so it was the most important place to start. They had a time of dedication right at the beginning of their building project. So friends, don't make the mistake of focusing so much on the work or the task at hand that you forget God. God wants your heart as you participate together. And in this chapter, I see six principles that will help each of us to participate. Firstly, leaders must set an example. We see this in chapter 1. If anybody in the city should have been busy with the work, it was the priests, for God's reputation was at stake. The priests would have worn amazing garments, and yet here the chief priest was, picking up rubble and laying bricks. He had no hesitation to swing a hammer or push a wheelbarrow, if they had those in those times, I don't know. You know, I take seriously my joyful responsibility to be involved in the work of ministry. And I don't have a problem getting my hands dirty. And it's important that church leaders, elders, trustees are on board with the mission and ministry of the church. Secondly, God uses all kinds of people. Verse 8 in chapter 3 says, Uzziel, son of this is why I didn't get you to read it out, Brenda. One of the goldsmiths repaired the next section, and Hananiah, one of the perfume makers, made repairs next to that. You know, God didn't need 1,000 masons and carpenters to rebuild the wall. He needed ordinary people who were just willing to work. People from a wide variety of different backgrounds, trades and localities gathered to work on the wall. The rulers and the priests worked together with regular people, some who even lived 10 to 15 miles away and travelled in. There was a place for everyone and a job for everyone to do. God has gifted each one of you, and each one of you is to be involved in a lifestyle of servanthood to Christ. And as we use our gifts, we will be fruitful. We will be fulfilled, the church will be built, and God's kingdom will increase. One of the key words in this chapter is the word section. It's used 13 times. The wall was divided and people were assigned a certain section to work on. And likewise, just as one person couldn't do the whole work by themselves, so too you and I are called to a certain part of kingdom. No one can do everything, but everyone can do something. Romans 12, verse 6 says, we have different gifts according to the grace given to us. Are you serving in your area of giftedness right now? And if not, perhaps it's time to find out where you can get involved. Thirdly, some people will not work. Having said that there is a place for everyone and a job for everyone to do, there will always be those who refuse to exert themselves. Most people worked, but some people shirked their responsibility. We see this in verse 5. The next section was repaired by the men of Tekoa, but their nobles would not put their shoulders to the work under their supervisors. Tekoa was a town about 11 miles outside of Jerusalem. And while some of the people commuted to the job site, the nobles from Tekoa called in sick. Actually, the text says that they refused to participate in the work of God because they didn't want to follow orders. They were too proud to submit themselves to the supervisors of the job. They were too important, they felt, to get their hands dirty. Anyone here today, I don't want you to put up your hand, but anyone here today who refuses to roll up their sleeves and get involved in the life here in Rayleigh? Well, if you are, you are missing out on one of the greatest privileges of all time. I can't think of anything more rewarding than being involved in kingdom work. You just can't beat it. Fourthly, some do more work. In every church and in every project, there will always be some who don't really participate, and at the same time, there will always be those who do more work than others. Those men from Tekoa, well, in verse 5, we read that they finished their section, and then we go down to verse 27, and they pop up again, refusing to follow the bad example of their leaders. These workers went the extra mile. I picture them coming up to Nehemiah and saying that they'd finished their section. Nehemiah asks them, well, do you want to do a bit more? And they say, bring it on. We're on a roll. We're keen. Let's keep on going. A guy called Binu did the same thing. Another guy called Meshulam completed one part and then he went on to another section. You know, sometimes we can have a tendency within most of us to finish the work that we've volunteered to do. And then we stop, we stretch out our arms and say, you know what, that was great doing the Lord's work, but I'm finished. Time to put my feet up. Not with these guys here in Nehemiah 3. They knew that kingdom work was never finished. When we complete one job for the Lord, we can't just sit back and think that we've fulfilled our ultimate responsibility as a Christian. As long as there is work to do in God's kingdom, there's work for you and I to do. So get involved. Fifthly, some worked with passion. In the entire chapter, there is only one man mentioned who worked zealously. Verse 20, Barak zealously repaired another section. The Hebrew word means to burn or glow, suggesting that he burned a lot of energy. He was not just serving, he was on fire. Everyone was working hard, but in a crowd of committed construction workers, Barak stood out among the rest. You know, we need people like him in churches who will say, I don't really care what others are doing. I'm going to do my very best. I'm going to do what God has called me to do. Anyone want to be like Barak here this morning? Are you willing to go the extra mile and burn with zeal and passion in your service and your participation? Are you tired of just going through the motions? Are you ready to get fired up and get involved for the kingdom? And then sixthly, some worked as families. The final principle from this great passage is that some people worked as families on a section either in the front of their home or another section away from their neighbourhood. At least six different workers, plus an unknown number of priests, repaired the portions of the wall that were nearest to their homes. And if all of us would follow this example, our streets, I truly believe, would look really different. Look at your neighbours, your neighbourhood, as your mission field. Befriend them, serve them, pray for them. And I want to challenge each one of you this morning to identify five neighbours that live near you and pray for them if you don't already. Even if you don't know their names, pray for the family who live at number 24, for example. As a church here, you are committed to make an impact in the town and beyond. But it's first to begin at home. Jesus told his disciples that he had appointed them to go and bear fruit. The word appointed means that he had strategically placed them. And the truth is that God has placed each of us strategically right where he wants us to be. If God's work is going to get done, we are each called to participate and cooperate with one another. Not compare or criticise. We must keep the main thing, by never forgetting that God's glory is at stake. Nothing has ever been done for God without some hard work. And in order to work well with others on a job that is much bigger than we are, we need to recognise the task demands everything we have. And God will equip us for the work he has. As I end, as I was driving here today, a gaggle of geese, I think that's what you call it, flew overhead. And I'd already planned to finish with this example today, so it was a real thank you God moment. I've actually seen it with my own eyes. You know, one of the fascinating things about geese is that they normally fly in a V formation. Geese often cover thousands of miles before reaching their destination, and they can only get to where they're headed if they work together. By flying as they do, members of the flock create an upward air current for one another. And by flying in this V shape, the whole flock gets 71% greater flying range than if each goose flew on its own. When one goose gets sick or wounded, two fall out of that formation and follow it down to help and protect it. They stay with the one who's struggling until they're able to fly again. The geese at the rear of the formation are the ones who do all the honking. It's their way of announcing that they are following and everything's going well. The repeated honks encourage those ahead to keep on going. And as I think about this, and as I thought about it as I was just driving here today, one lesson stands out above them all. It's the natural instinct of geese to participate and work together to enable them all to get to the place that they are going. Like runners on a relay team, everyone has to do their part if they want to win a medal. So whether it's flapping or helping or honking, the flock is in it together. They all stand together, as we saw earlier, which enables them to accomplish what they set out to do. How about you? You each have a part to play here at RBC and in God's mission to the whole world. Will you participate? Not because you're perfect, not because you've got it all together, but because you are invited to build God-centered communities. Let us pray. Lord God, we know that your word says that we are part of one body. And Lord, as many of us perhaps are still trying to find our place, Lord, reveal to us what you would have us do. Reveal to us truly how we can participate in your work, in your church. Lord, thank you that each one of us is called, is special, and is equipped. Lord, as we go out into the world, Lord, that we might be like those geese, encouraging, supporting, and equipping one another to fully participate in the kingdom work. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amazing. Thank you, Claire. It was quite a scripture. I read through chapter 3 when I discovered you were talking. I'm like, oh, my goodness. But no, it is good. And it's just interesting to see how they start building and how they continue building, how it just all comes together. We have got two songs to finish with. We sang it a little earlier, Build This House, and in the second verse, it's really key, and you mentioned it, Claire, we don't compare. And it says here in verse 2, so easy to desire what others have instead of seeing all the gifts that you have given me. It's so easy, isn't it, to compare ourselves. And imposter syndrome seeps in. I'm like, oh, well, I'm not good enough. I can't do that. I've got nothing to bring. And actually, we have all got something to bring. So we're going to sing this one together, and then we're going to go into Cornerstone, and it talks about Jesus being the cornerstone of what it is we're building. So let's stand and worship together as we finish this morning.
All the gifts that you have given me,
So help me find the flame which you began, and burn in me a love for you that all will clearly see. For unless you build this house, I am building it in vain. Unless the work is yours, there is nothing to be gained. I want something that will stand when your holy fire comes. Something that will last, and to hear you say, well done, giving glory to you, Lord. The sweetest praise, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
My hope.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' love and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest praise, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ, O Lord, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love, and through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all.
The hands and feet of God in Rayleigh. You are called to soothe suffering, to live with compassion, to build up God's loving peace. So as we leave this place, how will we live? We go from this place of worship to share the gifts we have been given, to go from this worship gathering to build up the body of Christ. We go from this space to carry the light of Jesus to the world around us. So go in love, go in peace, go knowing that God goes with you. Amen.